So IAM stands for Identity and Access Management. Okay, Identity and Access Management. Basically, it's for any IT company or any digital users or any financial sector. It belongs to any sector. It can be a financial, retail, medical, educational. So for everyone. Managing the user, managing the roles of the user, managing the policies, password policies, creating a user. So identity and access. So there are other again. It is a very vast thing. So I'm just dividing into identity management and access management, right? So identity management is all about creation of the user, right? Creation of a user, the managing the life cycle of the user. For example, like. And the there is some trusted source, maybe HR system. So manually they create that. Manually they enter all the users who are onboarded or employees who are onboarded. So that list can be made ready, and using identity management, those details which are already added can be made centralized and added to all like thousands of application. With the help of identity management tool. So such sort of thing can be done and then manage those the login purpose to log into thousands of the application server. We need access management also, and also we can make sure the network entity, some are intranet, some are in internet, some are not available since they are employees, something are not belongs to contractors. So contractors are very limited for the short time of period of time. They have again different rules for the access. So all these things can be managed by identity and access management. So again, it has variety of cloud and on-premise components or tools. So tools, when I say tools, if there are many tools in the market which has cloud, which provides SaaS model, which provides PaaS model, also on-premise components. It is a beginning and the traditional model. So yeah, there are a variety of options for that as well. Then user includes customer, partners and employees. So here when we say about users, right? So protecting the user, it can be customers, it can be end users, it can be partners. So basically for B2B model, for wholesale kind of business, partners and the employees, right? So employees basically which are again an internal customer, kind of internal customer. So we have to protect, we have to secure from, we have to be secured from that also. And many organization uses IAM for internal purpose as well. There are some other things like privileged access management, where whenever they log in to any of the server, it should be secured, like it should be audited, it should be secured. So any organization typically thinks on this is a first go for any big IAM concept. So again, IAM is like, if it is small, we can build it through code also, but since it is there are several tools present in the market, we can make use of that because it will be a very much centralized, not for each application we have to build IAM. It would be for every users, every application we can use only one single IAM tool. So devices include, it is supported for laptops, smartphones, servers, routers, so variety of devices. So we can implement like such policies where it can be used for, so whenever a computer user is logging in the app in smartphone, there is an app, so it does some OAuth call or some kind of call where a user gets the token and then it gets linked with some other application, third party application. So in smartphone also it can be used. So servers, routers, it can be a network related thing, where the identity and access management is useful, where which user got logged into which network. So those all we can log that, we can audit that, like we can keep the notes in notes as in like the logs. For any number of time, like 3 months, 6 months, it depends on the policy of organization. So yeah. So then we have the core objective of IAM system is one digital identity per individual per item. So it is like again, if I am an individual, I should have one digital identity. Okay, so basically, currently, what is happening if IAM is not in a picture? So what is happening? So user will have each user will have different identities in different application in different devices. So what it will do, like the we will not so like Aadhaar card, right? So currently, Aadhaar card is one example where there is a one identity. We don't have to showcase everything. It's like a one or maybe electronic passport. So whatever example you can take, right? In terms of digital identity, it's like a one user. I'm the only user who has access to many other applications. And real time people are using it. There is all only thing is like end users doesn't get to know what is happening in the back end. They just want ease of use, right? So for example, like whenever we click on facebook.com or whenever we click on youtube.com or whenever we click on any of the application, it gives so many easy interfaces where you don't have to give all the details. You just have to click on sign in using this, sign in using that. So it will take the identity from that particular application, and then the user is able to log in. So that is again some configuration is done in the back end which customer doesn't know. We have to see the ease of use. Users should not get every time they don't go and add their user details, their individual details, and create the user on their behalf. They have to be very easy so that it within a second they should be able to complete the transaction. They cannot give for each application. They cannot give the details because it is boring and people will not engage into it. So because of that also, IAM is very very much useful and everyone should be using that. All right then. Yeah. So how IAM works? So IAM basically. So it's just a very high level thing. Again, in detail, it will be as the slides moves, the concepts will be more clear. And then Oracle Identity Cloud Services, how it makes use of all these things and how it helps the IAM concept. So now the typical IAM comprises of four elements. So directory or identity repository of the personal data the system uses to define individual users. So basically, as I told you, right, HR system or Active Directory or any directory which currently the organization is using, that will have all the details of the user. So if there are 1,000 employees in a company, all the 1,000 users are stored in somewhere, right? So those data is one of the elements in IAM where we get the details of the user. Then we have a set of tool for adding, modifying, and deleting the data related to access lifecycle management. So any tool like where we can add that data or modify that data or deleting that data. So again, so whatever, even this thing is there where you change anything in this directory, automatically in this tool it will get modified. It's not like if it is changed here and manually again we have to change it here. There would be some automation here. Don't have to rely on the manual activity. There are some automation scripts, automation already the tools are using that. So this modifying data, deleting data, the tool should be there. Then we have a system that regulates and enforces user access. So it again entitlements and roles of the user. So if I'm the user, I belongs to sales team, right? So in I there should be some here. Whenever the HR enters the data, they have to they might be mentioning, okay, this employee is from the sales team. So he or she will be mentioning that detail. So if I am accessing any application, I should get sales detail. So for that, this is useful. And then auditing and reporting system. So which user logs in, which user got created, all the statistical view is one of the components elements in the IAM. So these four elements are typical, very typical IAM components. There are so many other things as well, but these four are high level elements. Well, so yeah, identity lifecycle management. So for example, like I'll start with the example because some of the concepts, some of the things point are added there. But yeah, so it's basically identity lifecycle management is completely, it's like a giving birth to the user And doing also how the user currently in the lifetime, like if I am the user, I born on some or the other day, I did my all activated, deactivated, I studied every details of that user when it comes to digital identity. That user got this access, this user got that access, this user was promoted here, this was moved on, the user was on long leave, the user was deleted, activated, inactivated, like same as how is our birth life cycle of an individual human. Okay, so it's same thing is managed by identity life cycle also, and there are several other tools, like many other tools. Okay, I'm just giving, even it has all the SailPoint, Sapient, IDM, IDCS. So it's not like only limited to identity lifecycle management, but those tools give so many other features also. Password management is there. Then we have governance, access governance is there. So user attributes, so everything as part of user details, right? It manages everything. Credentials, entitlements, user attributes, deprovisioning, provisioning. So all these things are handled by identity and lifecycle management. Yeah, so yeah, as I told you, Identity Cloud Service has this feature, and we will be going in terms of Oracle Identity Cloud Service, how it manages in next of the slide. So yep, so going to access management now. Okay, access management and identity management. So I'll be asking that question mostly, like identity management and access management, the difference between those things, maybe in the next slide. But yeah, I'll at least finish this slide. Access management refers to the process and technologies used to control, monitor the network access. Access management features such as authentication, authorization, trust and security auditing are part and parcel of top ID management system for both on-premise and cloud-based systems. So, as the sentence gives the clear understanding of what access management does, and again, it is just limited to this wording. It doesn't cover many things. But if I ask you authentication, what authentication it will do, which application it will give authentication to, all those configuration related to configuration, what protocols it supports, how which login form it gives. There are so many things. MFA, multi-factor authentication is there. Passwordless, there is no password you have to provide. You don't have to provide any password. So all those configuration Oracle IDCS gives. So access management features are this, but how to do? There are so many other ways of configuring the access management is done by Identity Cloud Service. That thing again, it will be coming in the next slide. But access management, the main pillars of access management are authentication and authorization. So what is authentication? So if we go, for any user, like going to any application, first step, even it's like going to anyone's house. Okay, going to anyone's house and click the ring. The first question would be who the person is. If the user is unknown, if user is not sure who he is, we will definitely not open the door, or maybe we'll just open and close it. It's something like that. Authentication, who the user is. It will be validated against the data store, whatever data store. So one more thing, as I told you, the four pillars, four elements which had a directory. That directory, the user will be there, and so the configuration would be like the application will go to the backend and go to that directory and check for that user and password. So that configuration again would be done in Identity Cloud Service to find out who the user is. Then authorization. Even though if I know, like somebody knocked my door, and I know who the person is, but he will be allocated to only such places where he has access to. Like if he's a part of my family, or if he's trusted, he can go anywhere. I'll not be able to check him. If the user is someone from the business employees or business, some who are less trustworthy, then we will just ask them to sit on the sofa and just don't have access to any rooms, any bedrooms, or anywhere else. So those kind of real-time example I'm giving you, right? So authorization here, who the user has right access to. If you are from sales team, If you are from sales team, you have logged in, you will be able to logged in. You will be able to log in, but you will find only sales related details on that application. You will not get any finance related details there. So that is authorization. That is limiting the user with the basic rights, minimum rights. It will definitely, if I'm the user, I'm from sales team, if I get access to all the details, like all the details as in all the domains or all the departments, I'll be able to know everything, right? So that is less secure. I am only belonging to sales, I should know sales. I don't have to go to the banking or finance or auditing or anything else. So that's where authorization comes into the picture, and various tools which in IDM also we showcase are various tools which helps us in AM. AM as in it's just a abbreviation to access management, CA SiteMinder, ForgeRock OpenAM, Ping Identity, Oracle IDCS. So in both this slide, I have used IDCS. So that's where a lightweight component, a very easy tool to use, Oracle IDCS is used for all those things. All right. So moving to next slide. Yeah, questions and answers. So please now I'm taking I'm giving you 5 minutes to ask me questions on this slide which we discussed, so that it would be interactive, and we can move to the next slide, which is a very important, the main aspect of this training, Oracle. Moving to that slide. So if you have any question before that, just shoot it, I'll answer. I see one question. IDCS integration can be done with any third party application or any. No, it IDCS integration can be done with third party application as well. Not limited to Oracle product, but depends on the license, what license you have. If you have standard, you will be able to get all these things. You'll be able to integrate any of the third party application also. And third party application as in like for both of the things, a single sign on and the user lifecycle management. How can you use client secret to authenticate via REST API? How can we use client secrets to authenticate it via REST API? Yeah. So you can authenticate via client ID and client secret using REST API. Yes, you can do that. There is some the grant type, the OAuth, using OAuth protocol, and client credential would be your grant type. So you just use your client ID and client secret, and the URL, IDCS URL, and you will be getting the token, and using that token the user is authenticated and authorized as well. Can we use web services to create user? Yeah. So all these things, the REST, using REST API, you can create an application as well. You don't have to log into admin console at all. You can do everything via REST API.